Welcome, everyone, to this program, this very interesting program today. I'm Leela Kinney. I'm the Executive Director of the Center for Art, Science, and Technology here at MIT, CAST. My partner in crime, the faculty director, Evan Zaporin, wave your hand, composer, musician, and I are very pleased to be able to support a robust visiting artist program. And Kat Cizek has been here over a period of 2 years doing a number of very fascinating projects. We're very pleased to have collaborated with, partnered with the Open Documentary Lab on this residency, and you're going to hear a lot more about what has come out of it today, and there will be a workshop tomorrow for the Open Doc Lab students and fellows as well. Now I'd like to turn the program over to William Uricchio, the faculty director of the Open Doc Lab, and he will give further introductions. Then we'll have an introduction from Sarah Wallison, and then we will have introductions from Kat of her co-panelists, so we're going to try to make this real fast. Here you go.
A many-layered operation. Actually, I just want to give thanks, and I'd like first to thank Kat for the project's presence and especially the process. And the notion of co-creation is so important to your work, has really been inspiring to us, so thanks very much. And thanks to CAST for making this possible. Open Doc sits at a space that really does connect a lot of parts of the Institute, the arts, humanities, and social sciences from our school, certainly, but we work a lot with folks over in the Media Lab with engineering. Documentary at MIT has a very interesting history, and we're trying to keep that tradition going and move it into the next century. So thanks, Sarah.
Thank you. I also want to thank CAS for making this residency possible. And really, just to let you know, this panel is a culmination of CAT's residency here with us for 2 years. And I just wanted to take a moment to honor her and thank her for her amazing work and how wonderful it's been to have her here. She's been incredibly generous with her knowledge. She's given workshops. She's spent time with students. She's a wonderful collaborator. And also, the panel today is about co-creation. And as the panel says, documentarians have always been at the forefront of innovation and really trying new technologies for storytelling. And Kat embodies that. She's someone whose documentary was the first one to use WebGL. She also was an early user of 360 video, but also not only the technologies, but the techniques. And she brings tremendous thought and ethics to her work and is really an inspiration for the field as someone who is really thinking about participation and voice in documentary. And that's what we'll talk about today, is co-creation. So thank you. And now I'm going to introduce the other panelists who are equally interesting and one that we're thankful to have in this panel. We have Andrew Lowenthal, who is a Open Doc Lab fellow as well, and also co-founder of Engage Media, which is a human rights social action video nonprofit. And Mandy Rose, here from England, who is an associate professor at the University of West England, and also someone, a really leading thinker and pioneer in interactive docs, and anyone who works in that field knows her. And finally, Ethan Zuckerman, who's the director for the Center for Civic Media, and also a really incredibly interesting scholar and thinker around civic media, and I'll let you take it from there. Thank you.
Thank you, Sarah. Thank you so much to Leela and to William and Sarah for this incredible opportunity tonight to be on stage with this panel, star-studded panel. But thank you for the last 2 years. This has been really life-changing for me to be at MIT. The project that I've been working on for many years and really bolstered by this residency or the visiting artistship. I always struggle with the noun for that. But the project that I've been really working on for many years and the last 2 years here at MIT was announced yesterday. We were able to announce that we'll be doing a sneak preview live performance of it at Hot Docs Film Festival in Toronto. They're really, really excited about that. And we're leading their first ever interactive documentary session, which is called DocX. So really excited to be part of that. And I have so much gratitude to MIT for that that this exists. I don't think it would exist without you guys, so thank you. In the spirit of co-creation, I'll be the participant moderator tonight. I've been practicing co-creation for about 20 years, and the last 10 years I've been honored to work at the National Film Board of Canada. So I'll take a few minutes at the top to set up co-creation, talk a little bit about my work. I think for the first time in 20 years, I'm not going to use slides. I'm not going to use visual material. I'll just talk a little bit for 5 minutes or so. And then I've asked each of the panelists to situate themselves within co-creation, what it means to us, and how they see it being practiced or how they've witnessed it. And then we'll talk a little bit amongst ourselves and then hopefully open it up to you sooner rather than later. It's a really important moment for me to see how we're starting to, I think co-creation has been around for a long time, but to come together from such different worlds and talk about it in a cohesive way is really exciting for me. So I'm really excited to have this evening tonight. I don't know how many of you know of my work at National Film Board. I'll just tell you quickly that I've been working on two mammoth projects in 10 years. The first project was called Filmmaker in Residence, and I was in residence at an inner city hospital. I co-created and partnered with nurses, doctors, patients, and academic researchers to see how medicine and media might work together to improve and even save lives. We did that for about 5 years, and unintended consequence of that project was to create the world's first feature-length online documentary, funded 100% by the National Film Board of Canada. And because of that, I think, because of this opportunity to bring things together in a new way on the web, the NFB came back to the senior producer, Jerry Flahive, and me and said, what next? How can we take this methodology and take it to another level? And that was the birth of High Rise, which has been my life for the last 6 or 7 years. And we look at vertical life of global citizens, mostly in suburbs around the world. And it's been an incredible storytelling prism to look at some of the largest issues of our time: globalization, migration, digitization, verticalization, all of it in very, very personal stories within the high-rise context. And we've put out over 20, I would say, media pieces, whether they're live installations or large global online documentaries, such as the one that we're just about to launch. So we've worked with many different kinds of non-media creators, architects, housing groups, government organizations, non-government organizations, academics, and in various different forms of co-creation to create very, from the outside, conventional-looking documentary. And I think tonight what we're hoping to really explore is the art and the technology and the ethics of co-creation. We're looking at how co-creation in documentary can be equated with democracy and with citizenship. I think in documentary, in conventional documentary, and in journalism to a certain extent as well, I think there's been an obsession with the author. And more recently, there's a new obsession with the audience and the users. And so much primacy is given to what the user gets to access, what the audience gets to see. And I think what we're all concerned with here is, what about the subject or the people formerly known as the subjects? How can we work to make things with people rather than about them, in the words of George Stoney, a wonderful American who came to Canada to develop the Challenge for Change program at the National Film Board of Canada in the 60s and 70s. And there's this counter history that Mandy has done such an incredible job of documenting in documentary and journalism, where the subjects take on an agency in the creation of media. I've had a chance to read quite a bit of work from everybody here, and Andrew referenced a wonderful story about how Grierson, John Grierson, the person who coined the term documentary, came to coin it. The definition he gave to documentary, as we all know, is creative treatment of actuality. But the way that he actually coined it was that he was reviewing Flaherty's film Moana in 1926 for the New York Sun on February 8th. 1926, and he used to write under the name The Moviegoer, and he translated the word documentaire into documentary in English, and thus we came to be. But the more interesting story behind that is something that Mandy, I learned from Mandy in one of her papers, is that in fact let's see, I didn't do the math before. It's 9 years later. Ruby Grierson, who is John Grierson's sister, introduced the idea of the subject as having an agency when she demanded that during the filming of slums in East End London, that, I think this is the quote, "The camera is yours," to the slum dwellers. "The microphone is yours. Now tell the bastards exactly what it's like to live in the slums." And it did the trick. The EastEnders, I'm quoting Mandy now, "The EastEnders' direct, albeit self-conscious testimonies are still arresting and affecting today, speaking to us across the years." And we could argue that this is really the germ of the idea of the DIY movement of passing that agency over. So documentary as a citizenship practice is really at the forefront of this counter-history. I think there's another important aspect to this discussion, which is how technology has really been at the forefront of so many of the people's movements in throughout history, but in particular within the last 100 or 200 or so years. And I made a film in 2002 with Peter Wintonic called Seeing is Believing, Handycams, Human Rights, and the News. And we document how this relationship between technological innovation has really paralleled social revolution. There's a wonderful sociologist in the Philippines that we interviewed, Dr. Alex Magno, and he said to us in our film, in the last two decades or so, he was speaking in 2002, most of the political upheavals have had some distinct link to communications technology. Iran, the Iranian Revolution was closely linked to the audio cassette. The first EDSA uprising in the Philippines was closely linked to the photocopy machine, and so we called it the Xerox Revolution. Tiananmen, the uprising that failed, was called the Fax Revolution, because the rest of the world was better informed than the rest of the neighborhood because of that fax machine. And the revolution in the Philippines in 2001, he thought, represented a convergence between electronic mail and text messaging, and that gave that uprising its particular characteristics. Of course now, 15 or so years later, we've got Twitter, we've got WhatsApp, and we've got all sorts of off-the-grid messaging systems, internet systems that fuel political movements. Looking to the future, we have virtual reality, big data, sensors, personalization, and all with the recognition that these massive webs of surveillance are at the foundation of most of our communication networks. But with the glitter of the technology, we often get blinded to the ethical issues that co-creation can offer us. And so I think that's where we want to go tonight, is to the past, to what we know today, but also with a hint to what we might expect in terms of co-creation for these future technologies that seem to get closer and closer to our brain. As these technologies kind of approach our eyes, go inside our ears, what does that mean for our agency as well? So I think those are all really important questions. I'll let the panel introduce themselves. Suffice it to say that I'm thrilled to be here with you all. Andrew comes from a video human rights background. Seeing is Believing was done in close participation with Witness, an organization in New York City started by Peter Gabriel and the Lawyers for Human Rights, so I feel like we're cousins or something. I feel like I'm cousins with Mandy as well. Mandy is a practitioner, researcher, phenomenal background with BBC doing groundbreaking work on participatory models that I think she's going to show us some examples of. And Ethan, also a cousin at Civic Media for your groundbreaking work on figuring out how to put the net back in our hands. So thank you for all that. And I'll start with Andrew. We'll go down. And then we'll start working on questions a little bit later.
Great. Should you present?
And I think everybody else has slides. So it's great.
I have slides.
Yeah.
So here you go.
Thank
great.
You, Andrew.
Can do.
This might be where we head to the front row.
Yeah.
Sorry. Bear with us for a moment. Okay, so we really have about 5 minutes to give you a quick overview of what it is that we all do and our ideas around co-creation. So this is really a quick, you know, smattering of the activities of Engage Media, which is an organization I co-founded just on 10 years ago, which very much fits into what Kat was saying around this idea of citizen witnessing, the kind of citizen media revolution, et cetera, and with obviously a very much relationship on documentary and the camera and the network. So our work is really working in Southeast Asia, but also globally in Myanmar, in Indonesia, in West Papua, in the Philippines, to assist campaigners around human rights and environmental issues more effectively use new media technologies and old media technologies to augment their social change work, so to augment their impact, essentially. So that's the kind of really very brief version. How that manifests is through an online platform for the distribution of that work, engagemedia.org, where we collect and curate video from around the region. We have a few editors located in different parts of the region, but also that then work with hundreds of people that we've done workshops with to really curate and collect that work, and then for us to like reach out to other media to again augment the impact of that of those issues and support those campaigners. So we're very much an activist project in that regard. We also do very specific interventions. So this is a co-creation project that very much fits into the tradition of participatory media and the work Kat was referencing before of George Stoney, of going to a community, working with them to enable them to use cameras and other devices to produce their own stories. So this was a piece of work called Papuan Voices, which is part of in West Papua, which is part of Indonesia, which is essentially under a kind of quasi occupation by the Indonesian government. Most people would like to be independent, numerous human rights issues, but a very bad kind of a very limited ability to get stories out from the region. So, and very much a kind of process where you can't just wait for the internet to arrive and then hope that people start blogging and distributing. It's very much a kind of situation where you need to go in, produce and hand over technologies to get people to start telling their stories, and then for them to be able to do it independently. So we're very much in an interesting position now with this after about 4 years, where we're completely handing over the project, or we're trying to work out how to completely hand over the project from something that was an initiative that we began to something that they continue on. And there are innumerable, obviously, ethical questions that come up in terms of how we do that, but also very practical questions around skills and resources and finances. Who's going to manage the website? How are people going to be organized? There's limited capacity around management and other issues that you need to be able to do to make these things function. And so what is our role as outsiders in that space, and how do we work in a way that really enables ownership and control and handover in that sense? This is another project that we did with migrant workers in Malaysia, very similar, but in this one we paired them with local citizen journalists to co-create together. So it was migrant workers from Indonesia, Nepal, and Myanmar, working with citizen journalists from Malaysia to co-produce videos about the situations of their lives. So, and in that sense, we were very much kind of absent, other than providing the capacity, providing the materials, and then doing the pairing, and then doing the support after that to let people loose and tell their stories, and then assist on the distribution side of that. Another kind of example of co-creation would be a network of subtitlers and translators, so coordinating or even just letting fly with having videos online, and people will, this is a video of one of the Papuan videos that, we go and look one day and it's in Russian, and so I think this kind of also this more organic co-creation is quite interesting, where through the network people start contributing in a very anonymous way because they find it relevant to whatever it is that they're doing. The work we do is based on an open source platform. Open source, I reference that more in the sense of like intersecting with the technology space and the software development space. And I think that co-creation can take a lot of reference, and already does in that sense, from the open source development community. So I'm very interested in how does that map onto, or what's the kind of contagion across from the open source development practices into the citizen media and co-creation fields as well, because they very much overlap. And then I think the other kind of space of co-creation that's really interesting for us is through more event and face-to-face-based activity. So how do you kind of create a space that doesn't have a predetermined outcome, which is what we often do through various camps. This is a camp called Camp Sambal that we hosted in Malaysia a couple of years ago, where it's very much a kind of, I guess, an unconference idea, but still with a particular trajectory that is to enable, like, I guess, the sharing of skills and the enabling of networks, and from that, further collaboration. So in some ways, the process becomes part of the outcome. So the sparking of new collaborations and the enabling of relationships and trust are really part of what co-creation is also about. It's not, the output is obviously extremely important, but I think the process is equally important, because it's the enabler, and it's what creates ownership. This is another one, Video for Change, which created a kind of network that's ongoing of similar organizations to us and Witness to collaborate more effectively and co-create knowledge and manuals, how-to guides, and a really kind of a repository for the field of what we call Video for Change, which is very much kind of co-creation space in terms of the ethics people are using here. So just to quickly define or think more about co-creation for us is definitely that process as outcome in its own right is critical for us, but also the balance between process and outcome. So how do you still have good outcomes with and not overemphasize the process? Because I think that's always been one of the difficulties in terms of that balance. The kind of how do you not go in with preset ideas when you actually might be tied to funders who want to see outcomes and have to go to and report back for what you've been doing with their money. So there are kind of limitations there in how that works and how much you can co-create, because you have to be accountable as well. So it's not a free-for-all. I like to think about inversing the question that Kat had before about the people formerly known as the subject in terms of how do we think about the people formerly known as the documentary creators and how have they changed? Who are they now? Because I think they have shifted quite significantly as well. And then really thinking about this reference actually to Ethan around bridge figures and what their role is in that space, because I think a lot of our kind of ethic and say for me is like I don't go into a lot of these spaces. It's very much about I'm a bridge figure to another bridge figure to another bridge figure who is the right person to be working in that place. And so I think, and that enables the trust that gives you the access to do these kind of stories that otherwise you wouldn't have. So, and then lastly, really thinking about what is co-creation without intermediaries. So here we're really talking about a group of people going in to another community with an idea, often a very open set of ideas, but often ideas that are very good around social justice and human rights. But what does co-creation look like without intermediaries as well? And I think a lot of that's already happening, but how do we also kind of capture that within the co-creation space as well? So that's me. Andy?
Hi. So let me just get out of here. And get into here. So yeah. So as Kat said, I'm a practitioner who became a practice-based researcher with a particular interest in documentary co-creation, or perhaps because of my interest in documentary co-creation. So I'm thinking about co-creation in two contexts, thinking about practices of collaborative making with those previously disenfranchised from media making. There are histories, as Kat suggested, there are histories of that within the history of 20th century documentary, histories where people deliberately worked to make documentary not just a shared practice, as it always was in a sense, but a practice where the power in the making was also shared. So we're talking about the George Stoney tradition, which will be invoked a number of times, no doubt. Community media, alternative media, and, for example, the Roosh tradition, Jean Roosh tradition of shared anthropology, which interests me a lot. And those ideas, those strands are really coming to the fore now in the context of digital. So I'm thinking about documentary history and I'm thinking about digital culture. as co-creation arises from that tendency within, or in the context of that tendency of computerization towards openness, as well as the growing accessibility in terms of cost and ease of use of production tools and platforms for making and sharing content. So those two dimensions together allow for the development now of new practices and forms for telling stories about our shared world, which is how Bill Nichols, the documentary scholar, defines the project of documentary storytelling about our shared world, which obviously is enriched if we are sharing the making. And I guess that's significant both for its meaning for, you know, for the public sphere. Documentary storytelling is a storytelling about our shared world and a discourse of the public sphere. And it makes a difference both to the stories that can be brought to light in dialogue, but also, as Andrew was suggesting, it's very importantly about process. And now we're more and more seeing media not just as a communication towards, you know, a content outcome, but actually a process of convening a dialogue, often a dialogue, a face-to-face dialogue. To quote George Stoney, who said, you know, every communication should end with a handshake or a kiss. And a lot of what we're seeing facilitated by the digital is actually face-to-face communication and dialogue. What Patricia Zimmerman has nicely called a politics of convenings. So I guess I have a very broad definition of co-creation, therefore, thinking of it as a shared process of meaning-making. And I've been involved in, at the BBC, during 20 years at the BBC, and a number of co-creative projects there. Voices, a dialogue with people of the UK about accent dialogue, a couple of examples of co-creative projects I was involved in as producer, executive producer in this instance. And I wanted to show you an example from this Video Nation project that I worked on for 6 years in the 90s, just on the sort of early edge of digital production, to tease out, in a sense, why the term co-creation is important to me. So here are some stills from Video Nation, and the title sequence that used to appear in various places, but actually every night, 5 nights a week on BBC Two, just before Newsnight at 10:30 at night, this little title sequence appeared. The faces, a kind of trumpet-like soundtrack announcing that a Video Nation short was about to appear. There were something like 1,200 of these shorts filmed by members of the public who we had given camcorders to, given some training to, and sent off home with those, inviting them to share recordings of everyday life made during the course of a year. It was, I think, the first time, and I'm not aware of a subsequent time, when those people had a contractual arrangement with the BBC which gave them a right of approval and veto over their material, so that nothing they recorded would be on television without them having seen and approved the shape of it. We did the editing, we watched the material, we talked to them on the phone, we were in constant kind of dialogue with them. So let me show you one of those shorts. There were longer programmes too. The shorts were just perhaps the most memorable and most often discussed. So here's one. I will do that.
Your hair is your power, and a lot of people respected me through my hair.
I can't believe I'm actually cutting all my dad's hair off.
You can't believe it?
I can't believe it happening either.
It doesn't matter what anybody thinks, really. It's because I'm doing it for myself, you see. I'm not doing it to please the crowds.
Colin, I can't believe you're doing this. I can't.
We always categorised and put in a box, yeah? Mm-hmm. And my hair put me in a box. So I'm jumping out of that box now, and for a while people are going to have to find out which box I'm going to land down in again, because that's what they like to do, put you in boxes so that they know what you are.
My dad's going to be so shocked. He sees you on Monday, isn't he? Mm. Everybody, I just can't wait to see everybody's faces.
Yeah? You're looking forward to that.
They'll say, who's this?
God, it feels a bit weird not having any hair on my head. I look like one of those guys out of the crazy house, man.
So I was hard put to decide one to show. How do I get out of here? Just one to show. But I think you can see, so Colin had the camera and he chose the moment to film and he chose what he was going to say and what he was going to show. You know, and it's very personal, but it's also a kind of meditation on identity and stereotyping. And a sharing of an intimate moment within his family. And I think you have to remember the context of 90, that was 96, that one was on, the context of 96, before 10 years before YouTube, when that kind of mode of filming was very unfamiliar, and popping up it within an evening's TV on BBC Two had a kind of impact that was quite particular. So during the course of the 6 years we were making programmes from this Video Nation material, I had this kind of odd response from my peers, my professional colleagues, which was people would say, oh, you work on Video Nation, how fantastic. And I would say, yes, and I would talk about the process and talk about the training and talk about the briefings we sent people. We sent briefings, very open topics. Show us a favorite or a least favorite thing, kind of prompts to filming. And I described this relationship. People would kind of get a bit disappointed. It was like, oh, I thought they just came in the post and you had nothing to do with it. And now I know you had something to do with it, I'm disappointed. That's not proper Access TV. We created this project in the Community Programmes Unit, the Access TV unit at the BBC. So I was troubled by this response, but I didn't really know what to do with that kind of feeling of trouble. I knew that there was value in the collaboration, that sharing our professional skills brought about documentary material that otherwise wouldn't have been made. I saw this partnership between the BBC as an institution and the people who were paying the licence fee as something which enriched the BBC output for everyone, for all licence fee payers, made a more complex and fuller picture of life in the UK. And I was aware that the project offered a response to what Henry Jenkins later, 10 years later, called the participation gap, the fact that despite the emergence of these tools that could enable participation, many people wouldn't be making content. Most of the people who took part in Video Nation wouldn't be making content. So I was kind of troubled by this, and it wasn't until around 2000 that I heard the term co-creation. In fact, in relation to some shorts made by Oxygen Media, a company in New York, Oprah Winfrey's TV station, I believe, that were made between the public and the professionals at the organisation. And it was like a kind of light bulb moment for me. This was suddenly a descriptor which allowed for the collaborative dimension, to describe the collaborative dimension of what the project I'd been involved in, but which in particular I liked because it rendered visible this issue of mediation. In saying co-create, it demands you to know that there's more than one set of people involved in the project. And so, sorry, I've got a quote that I think is interesting around this, which comes from a group of academics at QUT in Australia, a group which includes Jean Burgess. And so it seems to me that it turns one's attention on that process of mediation. The term complicates, as they say, the idea that participatory culture is a product of an autonomous relationship between the individual creator and the magic of technology. And I think that continues to be a very important thing for us to focus our attention on. So it asks about the ethical dimension. It asks, how is the sharing structured? Who sets the agenda? What is the agenda? What are the terms in that co-relationship? So that's the kind of space that I work in now, thinking about the ways that producers negotiate co-creation, thinking about their strategies around co-creation, thinking about the partnerships, for example, that Kat spoke about in High Rise and underpin the co-creative aspect of that project, thinking about the community workshops, for example, which Elaine McMillian and her colleagues ran to facilitate local participation in the Hollow Project in West Virginia. And a central question that arises is the question, how can participants not just take part as co-creators, but also define the terms of projects. And that's a really big, interesting, important question. And I think we can see in some of the projects emerging now little kind of suggestions of what a participatory design approach might be within documentary. So, for example, in the project Question Bridge starts not with the subjects being asked a question, but with them being invited to pose a question of each other. So this really simple device immediately frames the project as one which comes, in a sense, from the people taking part. And in the Kipu project, which was developed in the UK with a number of South American filmmakers that looks at forced sterilization in Peru in the late 90s, they've developed a very simple mechanism for bridging the digital and the analog, a phone system which can allow women to phone in, tell stories, their stories, women in remote, indigenous communities in remote areas, tell stories and hear the stories of others. So the phone, the analog phone, becomes a device for creating a community and for starting a co-creative documentary process in which process is key. So I hope we'll be able to talk about some of these examples a little bit more in a moment. Okay, thank you.
Hi, I'm Ethan. I'm not a documentary filmmaker. I am not an enabler of documentary filmmakers. I am not a scholar of documentary filmmaking. All of which leads to the strange experiences I sometimes have when people invite me onto panels where I sort of go, why the heck would you want to listen to me on this topic? But I realized after Kat invited me to come talk about this that I've lately become an accidental documentary filmmaker in the course of some of the other work that I've been doing, and I'm sort of hoping that I can actually talk with you about some of the ethical issues that are sort of resulting from me in doing this. So it's going to take a moment to explain how this actually connects to documentary, but to make sure that we're on familiar terms, we're going to start with a very familiar MIT image. This is Dr. Steve Mann. This is sort of one of the legendary Media Lab figures through history, and in many ways one of the first sort of inventors of wearable computing. And what Steve Mann did was decide that he really didn't ever want to be in a situation where he was without a computer. And so starting early in 1980, he started finding ways to wear his computing system at all time. There were a lot of other people in the 1980s trying to figure out how to do wearables here at MIT, but one of the things that was interesting about Steve's system is that his system always had a camera. It was always facing out, it was always looking at the world, and so in many ways he's sort of seen as the direct progenitor of Google Glass, and this sort of notion of having a wearable computer that is not only giving you information, but is sort of constantly scanning the world and constantly recording. And while Steve gets a lot of credit for his role in helping bring about Google Glass, which, by the way, he really dislikes and thinks is vastly inferior to many of the things that he's created, what I actually think he should be famous for is this idea of suvalence. And suvalence is this idea that he coined, which basically says when you have a whole lot of people with cameras, they can counter surveillance in some very interesting ways. When you have lots and lots of people aiming their cameras at institutions of power, you have a way of trying to counterbalance some of the power that comes from having an authority, an institution, looking at you, watching you, keeping track of you. Now, what's interesting about this is you can take this idea and push this in two completely different directions. The one that Steve actually tries to bring out is this notion that when I shine a camera at you, it is reminding you that you are now being watched by me. And it's a way of sensitizing you to the gaze of the camera, and ideally of reminding you how often we have cameras in our environment staring at us and who is actually controlling them, where is the footage ending up, where is my image going, and how powerless we are over that experience of surveillance. But what most people do when they hear the idea of surveillance is go, ooh, good, okay, now I'm gonna take my phone and I'm gonna hold people to account. And you can see that this is a tendency that comes up a ton within the activist community. You look at something like the Occupy movement, where it's become completely de rigueur to hold up your phone and live stream the protest that you're at as a way of essentially saying, look, if you're going to arrest me and you're not going to respect my constitutional rights, I'm going to be watching and broadcasting and looking back at you as a way of inverting power relationships. So I'm really interested in this question of, in reversing this gaze, in sort of moving into surveillance, can we actually make this work? Because a lot of the time, this doesn't work particularly well. It's an idea that works a lot better in theory than in practice. So one of the guys that I'm spending a lot of time learning from right now is a guy named Luigi Reggi. And Luigi is right now a grad student at SUNY Albany, but he was until very recently a data visualization expert for the Italian government. And his job was to do transparency projects around the use of EU funds. So EU is putting a lot of funding into Italy. Everybody is nervous about, is the EU really a good deal? Should we stay in the EU? And so what Luigi wanted to do is make it really, really easy for people to find out where EU funds were being spent in their neighborhood, in their community. And he built this utterly gorgeous site, Open Cohesion. It's beautiful. It's the best data you'll ever see. It's beautifully presented, and absolutely nobody uses it. Because this is the truth of most open data projects. You can make open data highly usable. No one really gives a damn. The problem is not the lack of information. The problem is what you could actually do with it. And so Luigi found himself thinking about umarel. And umarel are old men who spend their time in the streets of Italy looking at construction projects and sort of looking thoughtfully and sometimes offering their opinions of, oh, well, I wouldn't do it that way. But you can see they show up all over the place. And so Luigi said, what if we could take the power of the umarel? What if we could take the power of the watchful citizen and use this as a tool for political power? And so what we started saying was, look, of all these tens of thousands of investments that EU money has come into Italy, what's it done? I want to audit these. And so he just started showing up with teams of citizens to say, hi, you've got a pile of EU money. We'd like to see what you've done with it. And would write up a formal report, essentially saying, oh, well, that's really interesting. You built a travel planner at the cost of $100,000, and six people have used it so far. It's a very nice travel planner. It was probably not the best way to spend the money. I'm going to give that one 2 stars. And so he started doing this throughout Italy. He's particularly doing this with high school students. And the idea is that this is a great way to teach high school civics. Here's where the money comes in. Here's where it goes out. It is our right as citizens to go out and monitor what's going on with those funds. So this is an example of something that I call monitorial citizenship. And for me, monitorial citizenship is a shift away from the way we're normally told to be citizens. We're told that our job is to read the newspaper, watch public television, listen to public radio, be informed, and vote. And that's a really thin broth. Showing up every 2 or 4 years to have some sort of participation in the democratic process is not a particularly robust form of citizenship. So I'm really interested in this question, can we turn citizenship into something that we do every weekend, or perhaps we do every day? Can we move from being informed but passive citizens to effective citizens who are finding some way of using that ability to watch and to document as a form of political power? And so what that's done for me is it's had me spending a lot of time lately in Sao Paulo, Brazil. And the reason for Sao Paulo is the convergence of 3 factors. One is that Sao Paulo elected this really interesting mayor, Fernando Haddad. And this guy's crazy. He's a wonderful, progressive, far-left mayor who came into office and did something that you sort of wish all politicians would do. He published a 200-page book of the promises that he wanted to be held to in his 4 years in office. And these are not vague promises. These are not like, I'm going to make Sao Paulo livable and innovative. They're things like, I'm putting in 170,000 lampposts, and I'm putting 23,000 in Zona de Este, and 20,000 in this neighborhood. And one of the reasons that Fernando did this is that this guy, Oded Greju, was whispering into his ear. Oded is the founder of the World Social Forum, and he said, look, if you want to bring trust back to Brazilian politics, you've got to make concrete promises, and we've got to hold you to them. And Oded said, I'm going to help you. I run a group, Redenosa Sao Paulo. It's an association of neighborhood community organizations, and we're going to watch what you're doing. But the problem is there's no good mechanism for this. Even with 1,300 elected representatives to hold Mayor Haddad to his campaign promises, we don't know how to do it. So we've come in and basically are trying to think about this question of, can we create millions of Brazilian numeral? Can we, using the mobile phone, shift this idea of monitorial citizenship and make this an everyday thing that happens in Brazil? So we've been building a platform called Promise Tracker, which asks people in Brazil to go out and find an issue that they care about and start mapping it in their neighborhoods. And the issue that I found myself working with a team on a very sweaty morning in Belo Horizonte was cojimal, railings. If you live in a favela, you don't spend a lot of time walking on the streets. You spend a lot of time walking up and down staircases. They're basically what links together a hilltop neighborhood. And they're really, really dangerous, in part because they don't have cojimal. And so the idea behind this was the people in the community got together and said, what do we want to map about our community? We want to map all the staircases, and we want to show which ones are dangerous. We want to show how they come out. And I'm looking at this, and I'm going, this is great. This is how we combat big data. Rather than having an official data set, we're going to have a community-organized data set. It's kind of come from the ground up. We're going to go and get GPS readings in all of these. I'm walking around with a former drug dealer and gang member trying to figure out how we're going to map all the staircases in this neighborhood. And then this happens. We're looking at this staircase. There's an old man climbing the staircase. My team turns to me and says, we got to talk to this guy. And so they run up the staircase and they start talking to him. And the gentleman says, you know, 50 years ago, I built this staircase. I was actually part of the team that built this, and this was the pride of our community because this was what connected our neighborhood to the rest of the city. And then last year, I fell down the staircase and broke my hip. And now I think of my younger self, and what I want to say to him is, cojimal, we need railings. We need some way to have these things be safe for everyone within the community. So I thought I was collecting data. And what the people that I was working with told me almost immediately was that what they wanted to be doing is making documentaries. And so they were filming that moment. And we suddenly had to wrestle with this application that we'd been building. We build appropriate technology. We try to build lightweight software for the developing world. And now we suddenly find ourselves essentially saying, we have to find the way to accommodate the stories that people want to tell. And this is pushing us in really interesting ways. So this is now in Sao Paulo. We tried this out in Belo Horizonte. It's always a good idea to try stuff out in Belo Horizonte. It's a lovely place. We came to Sao Paulo, which is a little more complicated, and we found ourselves saying, what do you want to map? What does this community organization want to map? And the women we were working with were in the practice of occupying residential buildings throughout Sao Paulo. Housing is the issue in Sao Paulo. The city is so big that most affordable housing is about 2.5 hours commute out of the central city. So this neighborhood, Sé, which is one of the oldest neighborhoods in the city, is filled with abandoned buildings that are under 24/7 police protection. And they're under 24/7 police protection because if they weren't under 24/7 police protection, they would be immediately occupied by these women who are affordable housing activists who would move in with all the people that they work with. And so we found ourselves saying, well, this is great. One of the goals for Sao Paulo is more affordable housing. Let's just map that. To which the women said, not our goal. We didn't write that goal. We don't trust the mayor. This wasn't our plan. We don't believe that building new housing is the way to go. We want to figure out how to occupy the houses that are there.
So we said, okay, great. I bet our tool can do that too. Let's figure out how we map these abandoned buildings. Let's figure out how we map whether they're being patrolled or not. Let's figure out how we might find a way to estimate who could end up living there. And once again, we found ourselves essentially thinking we were collecting data and finding ourselves essentially making a film of these women walking the streets and talking about not just that the fact that these buildings were unoccupied, but why they were unoccupied and whose responsibility it was that they were unoccupied. So here's the challenge for us. We're trying to build a project that scales. We want to help this city, the largest city in the Western Hemisphere, make a map of how effectively are they taking things on like low-income housing. And rather than essentially saying, okay, we're going to hire 10,000 people to map the city, we're looking for co-creation, we're looking for participation. But what we're discovering is that as we head down this path, we end up almost entirely on the particular. We end up on the personal, we end up on the story. And we think it's incredibly powerful because what we want to come out of this work is for people to have the ability to create their own documentaries out of this data. We think the real value of this data is not having a comprehensive map of the city of Sao Paulo. It's having a data set that combines the individual facts, the photos and the readings and the documentation at a specific place on the map, but also the stories that people want to tell with this. And so my students and I are working together on this tool to think about how do we make it possible not just to collect and map this data, but how to pull a data-driven documentary out of it so it becomes a tool for advocacy for the community's issues, a tool for advocacy within the media, and a tool for advocacy within the community and looking for situations where you can solve it yourself. But the question I want to leave you with is not just a question about the author or the auteur with the camera, the rights of the subject, the rights of the audience. I want to ask this question about the technologist as well. We didn't come into this thinking of ourselves as filmmakers, but what we ended up realizing was the tool that we ended up creating and the prompt that we ended up giving ends up turning the people who end up using the system into documentarians. And the ways in which we construct the technology attaches certain affordances to it. The current version of the tool that we're trying out in Sao Paulo right now does photos, but not video. And that's because we're really worried about, are people going to be able to upload these massive files sort of associated with it? So at that point, in that single decision, we have shut this off as a documentary project in terms of video documentary and turned it into photo documentary. What's the role of the technologists building these systems as well? It's not just the author, it's not just the subject, it's not just the audience. I don't mean to be a techno-determinist in this, but anytime you're building a technical system, it has a politics behind it. It has affordances for what it makes easy and what it makes hard. And we built a system really based around this idea that we want a geolocated community source data. And now we're realizing that what we may actually need to do is figure out how to build and co-create documentaries coming out of these communities that we're working with and figure out how we adapt our tool to that. So those are the questions that I'm wrestling with. I hope they relate enough to this, Kat, that it gives you something to work with, but it's a pleasure to be here. Come on up.
Wow, that's a lot to chew on. This is great. I'm going off in a whole new directions of what co-creation could and should be. I think we've challenged, you know, who can be the subject or the people formerly known as the subject. We've challenged people formerly known as the audience. You've questioned the documentary maker, which I'm really wrestling with right now, and Ethan's introducing the technologist. So I think we've got a lot to work with here. But ultimately, what I'm hearing is there's this mysterious, magical mixture in here, which is the power of the story, and how it's you can't wrangle it in a way. It's something that gives that meaning. It gives that personal connection to why we're collecting the data or the the video images or the photography in the first place. And I think that that's at the heart of co-creation. That's at the core of it, is trying to figure out how to tell good stories together. And I think, Andrew, you talking about the elimination of the documentary maker, that to me is very provocative, because I think for me, co-creation is very much about this idea that documentaries don't make themselves yet. Yeah. We don't have the algorithm for it. And so how do we continue working on the human algorithm together, as opposed to just having one person control that? And also, I think Ethan's wonderful and thoughtful and practical approach to this idea of the informed citizen turning into what you call the monitorial citizen. For me, that very much resonates in the documentary journalism world, of moving from a broadcast model where you're just dumping information on people and expecting that that's what they need in order to vote, to this participatory model as well. So I think we can go to you, Andrew. You sound like you want to respond.
Well, no, I don't want to completely abolish the documentary maker. So I think that's that. No, but so for me, the interesting thing is, like, what has changed in the subjectivity of the documentary maker, and who is that subjectivity afforded to? So, and how, and because I think it was for a very long time a very defined occupation, which, as were many occupations, that then once, you know, the network and digital, et cetera, came on board, and it became much easier to do those things that previously were the remit of a very small group of people, basically completely changed what that occupation was and therefore what that identity is. So I'm definitely not getting rid of the documentary maker, but then I'm interested in, well, how does that person change, or who can become that person, and what becomes of the people who were very attached to the previous identity? How do all those different groups then interrelate? Because I think, so what does it mean now to be a documentarian? So who is a documentarian? I mean, I think in some ways, on some level, we're saying anyone who picks up a camera and presses, you know, record on their phone. But on another level, maybe we're saying that's still very much a kind of very basic witnessing activity, and it's not enough to be called a documentarian. And certainly wouldn't get rid of the storytelling, because I think one of the key things we've found is that, giving someone a camera is not enough in terms of creating some kind of real impact. I mean, I think there are kind of examples that get held up that people show, like, you know, Rodney King video or various others, which suggest that all you need to do is shoot the video and something will happen. And I think that worked for a while, I think, when there was a certain amount of scarcity to those images, whereas now you have hundreds of thousands, millions of images, and there's a certain kind of fatigue as well, where those images don't have the level of impact that they used to have. So the idea that you used to kind of show some evidence and then something would happen as a result, I don't think actually holds up anymore. There's some other kind of like golden key that turns that video, that piece of film, into something that has some kind of resonance and engages people with it, engages people enough with it so that something, you know, tangible happens within society as a result.
Like you said earlier last week to me, who gets to co-create? Who gets the honor of that? And I guess that makes me wonder, Mandy, how you, was it you who convinced public institution like the BBC to co-create with?
No, it wasn't me who persuaded them to. In fact, Video Nation was the second camcorder project that the Community Programmes Unit had been involved with. It had already run something called Video Diaries for a couple of years, where the Video Diaries were like 50-minute programmes, the story of one person generally going through a kind of moment of transition in their lives. And in the case of Video Diaries, there'd be a producer from the Community Programmes Unit working very closely with a member of the public on the story. So it wasn't me who persuaded them to, but myself and a colleague, Chris Moore, were very involved in setting up Video Nation, which was itself inspired by a much earlier and very interesting British project called Mass Observation, which was a project that began in the 30s through which people wrote diaries about their everyday lives. So it wasn't the first occasion, but it made a lot of impact because of the kind of slots that it had and because of the numbers of people who were involved and the length of time that it ran.
But even for there to be room at a public institution to be doing that is remarkable.
Yeah, although I think, you know, I think there's an interesting book by Georgie Bourne, an anthropologist. It was a study of the BBC through those years in the 90s called Uncertain Visions. And she's very clear about the marginal position that the community programs unit sat in vis-a-vis the kind of power of the within the institution. And but we were lucky to have what I thought was a kind of prime time slot in that slot at 10:30 at night, even though the pieces were short. And and if there'd been like a football match before, sometimes there were like 4 million people watching. So that was significant in the UK.
And did you consider yourself a documentary maker when you were editing that material? Were you the author in some respect of Video Nation? Or what are your thoughts on authorship?
As I explained through that kind of anecdote about the kind of response to the project, you know, we deliberately didn't put our name on the end of the programs, for example. You know, we thought about it. We thought, well, hang on, that would be kind of odd. Why would it be my name? That person shot the material. But in a way, that was a kind of disavowal of just how involved we were. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so it was like that kind of access issue, the idea that access was about handing over and then stepping back, and we never stepped back. Although what I thought we were doing in the editing room, and I believe that's what people who took part thought, was seeking moments when they were in full stream, saying something that they were very keen to say, communicating something, you know, capturing a moment in family life that clearly was precious and important to them. And in a sense, what we asked them to do is to speak aloud their values, their thoughts, their concerns. And in doing that, you know, it felt clear. I mean, you know, this is obviously a very subjective thing to say, but it felt clear in that material when somebody was on, when they were in full performative mode, imagining the BBC audience listening to them. You know, in a sense, that's perhaps what we were doing with the brushes.
Part of what was so interesting to me, Maddie, about hearing you talk about it was talking about the prompt and talking about mm-hmm. the ways mm-hmm. in which mm-hmm. people thought the prompt was sort of not fair game, that these things were sort of magically appearing, and in fact mm-hmm. what you were doing is mm-hmm. prompting mm-hmm. And then editing, which to me actually mm-hmm. feels very much authorial. Mm-hmm. But completely consistent with the spirit of co-creation. Mm-hmm. And what I find myself sort of thinking about in the work that we're doing, I don't think there's any chance that the activists that we've been hanging out with were going to go hang out on a street corner and make a documentary that day. Something in the prompt of essentially saying, please go out and collect some data, turned into a prompt to essentially start thinking about making a film. And so I think in thinking about this in the framework of co-creation, I've started thinking about that as, okay, well, that's authorial. I mean, we're thinking about what sort of issues we want people to pay attention to. We have all sorts of guidelines around this. We want you to look at infrastructures so that they're tangible and physical and mappable. We want you to think about things that the government has responsibility for, and therefore you're in dialogue with the government. And then I was thinking, at least, you know, at the end of it, we're not editing the final cut. But then I realized, of course, you know, Heather Craig is working on a master's thesis right now, which is very directly related to this, and it's trying to figure out how you might pull a documentary out of this data set. And even decisions of, is it 3 points on the map and the photos associated with it, or is it 6 points on the map? Do you do a voiceover under it? Do you prompt for that? All of those are sort of affordances that we put into the tool, but all of them end up sort of shaping what that output ends up coming like. And so I find myself, in the course of having this conversation, getting more comfortable with at least sort of taking on that co-curator role, although our intention in this would never be to actually edit any of those finished videos. In most cases, we're probably not even going to see those finished videos. But thinking about the prompt and the structure as also part of the authorial participation.
Well, and further to that, it's something that I think we've all touched on, is the power of the interview, the power of the question giving, and handing that over to, in Question Bridge, for example, asking subjects to ask each other questions. I think what you've stumbled across, Ethan, in your process is, on the streets, the power of letting other people talk about what's important to them becomes a very political act. And in fact, I've argued in a lot of the work that I've done, and certainly Challenge for Change at the NFB, that there wasn't ever even a final film product, that it was just the process of using interview techniques or taking a photo that could be reason enough to call something interventionist media. So it's even just pulling back at that idea that we have to have something, a product at the end, to somehow justify the process that we go through. But that said, I think my interest is how do we come to something that becomes a universal story? And that's where you can take something very local and very specific, but then somehow make it resonate for the rest of the world, which I think is part of that magic that we've been talking about as well, in terms of the question, the story, the context that we allow for people to engage with each other on that.
One thing that comes to mind when you say that, though, is wondering about, and we were talking about before, the audience in terms of, does it need to be, I mean, Universal is a very particular audience as well, right? In terms of who you're aiming to have the story resonate with. And then so what is the relationship to a story that doesn't resonate with, maybe only resonates with a very, very small audience, but that might be enough in terms of what its objectives might be. So I think, and then how do you, what's your role as a co-creator in universalizing that? And I think this is something that we grapple with, where we are working with Papuans, with Indonesians, and then with me as an Australian, and that we all kind of have different experiences in terms of I have, you know, more access to Western audiences, and so I understand what they might be interested in, and if, and that might be considered in some way the universal or standing in for. Someone else understands what the Indonesian audience looks for. Someone else understands more what someone in this village or in this city is looking for. And then how do we kind of negotiate that in terms of if we're creating a finite singular product in terms of like a short video where it all has to somehow come together, and then whose tastes and preferences do we preference? And so if it, and which comes down to the aims of the project. So it, there they might be saying, well, it only needs to speak to the people in this general vicinity or in the other city, or we need to, or, and the Indonesians might be saying it needs to speak to a Javanese population, and I might be saying, well, actually it needs to speak to this population, which comes back in some ways to a political analysis around, well, who can shift this issue, but then everyone has different ideas about that. So I mean, I guess the point being,
I just want to jump in and say, well, why make one thing? Yeah, and that's part of, I think, totally, the beauty of co-creation is the possibility to do make multiple things that come out of it, so that you're serving different audiences and doing different things. Yeah. And I guess I want to make a strong argument for the art of co-creation, and that there is a possibility to also be making art that is, you know, can be for a universal audience, but can also be very local and specific. So, multiplicity, but art.
Totally. And when I think then the technology is really interesting in terms of can you have it be both multi-authorial and multi-audience, if that's a phrase. But like, because I think the technology increasingly affords that, enables you to do that, where you can have different products. I think it comes down to a resource question, but I think the barriers to entry for that are also lowering.
So Mandy wants to say
something. Yeah, but I guess I'm just thinking that we have to also see the technology as part of the mediation. Mm-hmm. So, you know, we're talking about the idea that the role of the author doesn't disappear, but it kind of morphs into these other roles in a co-creation situation, whether that's kind of catalyst or whether that's about framing. So these kind of different positions, that's about creating a kind of architecture for a website, or what you were discussing, that, you know, that's an authorial role in a sense, isn't it? That kind of, you know, drawing the wireframe for that website is a kind of authorial role in that context. And the technology, again, is an authored piece, you know. I mean, I think Alexandre Brachet from Oupien puts it brilliantly. He talks about the interface being content. And the interface in these projects, the way you present an interactive or a co-created project to the world, is part of the content you're producing and is part of your authorial work. And in a sense, you know, then it comes around to the kind of issues of ethics and the kind of way that relationship is kind of negotiated, discussed, understood, and kind of the way that the project is jointly set out. And I mean, that's a much longer conversation. I don't see there as being one way that must take place, but I guess we all think, we were in a conversation earlier about ethics, that the transparency is key to that. Transparency and openness of that.
So I think transparency is also the solution to what feels to me like a little bit of an ethical dilemma that I think you're opening up, Kat, which is in both Andrew's case and my case, we're producing activist documents, right? They have a theory of change associated with them. The theory of change associated with the videos that we're creating is really blunt, right? It basically says, either you're going to persuade the mayor, or you're going to persuade the press, who are going to try to persuade the mayor, or you're going to try to persuade your neighbors to make this change along with you. It's, you know, 1, 2, 3, pick your three. Those were the audiences that you were looking for in sort of building this out. you come in and sort of say, no, this is a universal story about community aspiration, and look at the ways in which Sao Paulo reflects Baku, reflects, and if that's transparent, if that's the vision from early on, as it has been with High Rise, and sort of talking about this as participation in something much broader and much more global, that to me feels like a good solution to the problem. It feels to me like a very bad solution to the problem if I somehow use this as my method to create a great, you know, sort of well of footage, which I then find myself using to try to make that sort of universal statement. Mm. In shifting from the audience that author was shooting the video for to that different audience, that actually feels, for me at least, like shifting onto very uncomfortable ground, unless there's a way that I'm sort of able to frame that very, very early within the project.
Absolutely, and I think it's thinking about art in service for the political goals. I think that's how I'm thinking about it. Is how do we engage in storytelling, and not just data, because that's what we're all searching for. You can create as much data as you want, and you can have as lofty political goals for it as you want, but if it doesn't translate or engage people's hearts or minds in really profound ways, then it's not doing what you intended to do. So I think that's the secret sauce that we're talking about, for sure. I'm going to open this up to you guys.
So Ethan, all of you. So I'm thinking about, it's wonderful and it's really thought-provoking, and I'm thinking about a hackathon that I went to, an open data code for America hackathon that came here, and it's very process-oriented, but in the end, the community gets to watch what people have invented. And when I think about what you're doing, I think it would be so cool to have at the end, like a little festival, so to speak, where the community could come and reflect to each other what they're thinking about, what the infrastructure issues are to them. And so I just want to put that out there.
Yeah, no, thank you. The model that we've been using for this, we work with a participatory design methodology, so we're building the software in sort of rapid iteration with the people that we're working with. And so what's going on right now is our lead developer on the project is now living in Sao Paulo for the next 2 months. Every 3 days, she's running workshops with people, introducing the tool. They're going out, mapping, creating work. They're coming back and looking at the maps that are coming out of this. They're reflecting on the process, on each other's work, on each other's priorities, and then we're iterating the tool and then trying with another group. We realize that that's not scalable as is. So the next step of that is training trainers to try to figure out how people then go out into neighborhoods. The next level after that is to sort of say, once you've got a pretty good map of some infrastructure, can you go into media in one fashion or another, whether you're going to follow to Sao Paulo or something else, and essentially saying, look, here is the state of our streets. Can you help us participate? And can you help us sort of grow from there? So it's very much a component of sort of what we're trying to do. But I think at the same time, we're very conscious that this sort of notion of wanting to map infrastructures, wanting to do it citywide, wanting to do it with a geographic component, and wanting to do it with the monitorial piece of it is very much our agenda. And I think we're going to continue feeling very uncomfortable with the project until we get a strong uptake of people essentially saying, no, this is our agenda, this is what we want to do with it, and they're driving the process. Right now, we are very much driving the process. And actually getting to that point would be a point at which the community is telling us what to do with the tool, and that's really the aspiration for it.
There's somebody who says, I think there's a story to be told here, or we as this group think there's a story to be told here. How should that happen? And I guess I'd be curious to know, Ethan, you talked a little bit about, you both talked about instances where you sort of thought, oh, maybe it'll be like this, and it turns out to be something different. And I guess I wonder, it seems like that initiator role is something, is there something a little bit sticky about it? And I just,
that seems like a place that could be uncomfortable, and I'd be curious to hear like a story or two about that.
Story. Interesting. Yeah, I mean, in a way, it's the initiator role I was pointing to it when I was talking about the challenge in co-creation is about how you share the kind of, in a sense, the initiation, how you share or how you devolve or how you make a space where projects can be initiated, not necessarily by the professional maker. So I think it's less a sticky thing, but more a very, very interesting question. I often think about YouTube and think it's just sort of seems to me, it strikes me as at the heart of YouTube's problematic, that there is no inbuilt architecture that invites connection between stories which have strong connections, which between them could become movements, you know? I would love to see more kind of organic architectures emerging, or, you know, that can allow that. But in many of the projects we're talking about, there is a professional initiator who, you know, looks the co-creative project in the eye, one hopes, and thinks about the kind of their responsibility and ethical position in the relationships.
I mean, Kat, this really feels like a question for you, yeah. Right? I mean, you're initiating on global scales around these projects, and you're putting forward prompts, and you're doing an enormous amount of work, you know, towards something that is both local and global at the same time. The problematics that I'm putting forward with it is that, do you find that to be a sticky area, or is that very much within the space of, no, that's absolutely where I'm going as a filmmaker, that's the first step in that process?
Yeah, I think that's exactly where it becomes interesting. That for me is where, oh, okay, this is interesting now. I have to think about what is my agenda, what are my funders' agendas, and how do I create a space to define this project? So to design the project itself. And while at the NFB, I've had an incredible opportunity to not be defined by the form. So I'm not going in saying, I'm making a 52-minute film about this. And then that automatically puts into place a bunch of things that you have to do in order to get there. But it's not just with the NFB. I think that there's an opportunity as an initiator to go into a relationship and say, these are the things I'm good at. I know how to work with cameras. I know how to interview people. I know all sorts of things. And at the beginning of High Rise and at the beginning of Filmmaker Residence, and to a certain extent, most of the projects that I've worked on, I've tended to come in and say, these are the things I'm kind of good at. What are you doing right now? I've heard about you, and you've what are your primary concerns? And then build the project out of that. So High Rise didn't start as a project about High Rise. It came about through really intense conversations with primarily architects and urban planners in Toronto, and really looking at specific tower blocks in Toronto that were falling apart. And there was this plan, this tower renewal plan that was put forth to the city. It was a city initiative to try and recycle them and renew them. And out of that came this notion of high-rise, and that was through many, many, many conversations. I mean, that I would never own that idea. It was really through the opportunity for me to have those conversations. And it started, high-rise started off as a very Toronto-centric project, and then it was really through a conversation with a German broadcaster who never ended up being part of the project in any way whatsoever. I started telling her about it. She goes, but that's a global story. Mm. And I hadn't thought of that. I thought, okay, well, what if we tried to look at this as a global story? So we kept pushing it by having multiple conversations. And not every aspect of High Rise would be suitable for any or all of the partners that we've partnered with in it. And that's okay. Like, we're not trying to serve everybody at the same time. But we're hoping that the sum is greater than, you know, the whole is greater than the sum of its parts, in the sense that it becomes a larger useful tool for people to make things happen in local communities. So I don't know if that answers the question, but it that sticky part is the part that excited me and excites me about co-creation. And what bores me is having an agenda and saying, this is what I want to do, and trying to convince you to do what I want you to do. That bores me.
I mean, I think for me, it's also a much bigger question that you could go far beyond just thinking about video and media. It's kind of what is the role of the political activist in and their relationship to community or a social movement or whoever it might be. And I think that's a very centuries-old kind of question that people are grappling with. And for me, this is part of that question, is what is my role as someone who has a particular political agenda, but is broad enough to encompass and work with people. I mean, how do you not go and be a Che Guevara and turn up in Bolivia and basically have no one interested in what you're doing because you're not interested in listening to anyone and get yourself shot and killed and everything fall apart? You don't want to be doing that, right? So I think that's a bad idea. It doesn't work. Even if it worked, it would still be a bad idea because there are all these other repercussions that we've seen throughout history about that model. And so I think for me, it's also about a shift politically in terms of how people think about working with and engaging with people with around very important political questions and questions of power. I think these are questions of power that relate to, one, how do you work with other people, and then they are about questions of power in relation to how does that group of people relate to the state or other powerful interests. And so I think they should be sticky questions. They should be difficult questions because they don't have easy answers, and they should be things that people are thinking about continually. And if they don't think about them, then I think that's where you end up at the bottom of a marsh in Bolivia.
There's a humility in that. Yeah. There's a humility in not knowing the answers, and that's the process of documentary for me is a true process of discovery, where you don't have the answers and you don't know what you're going to do, and that's where I think where documentary aligns really well with academic research when you're setting up questions and trying to answer them. So many documentary projects, conventional and co-creative models, have the answers before they've even started, and that to me is not just bad co-creation. It's bad documentary. So. I don't know if Mandy, do you want to?
No, I'm just going to say Jean Rouch enters the room again. You know, he saw filmmaking as a kind of research, and I think that's what we're talking about. Why would you want to do a piece of research without involving a group of people who have special interests and can bring skills, including the skill of you know, the expert skill people have in the circumstances of their own lives,
first lived experience.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Took over the mic. Do you want to? Okay. So actually, I had a follow up to Ellery's question. which is, it seems like the lifeblood of a lot of these projects is sort of the input of the participants themselves, and then to some extent, kind of the attention of audiences that you can build around it. And Ethan mentioned the work of. I think it was the Italian guy that sort of like built this platform and then nobody came. And so a lot of what I've been exploring through my research is sort of the role that institutions play in this work and sort of how it gets funded, how it gets sustained. It seems like it's very difficult not only to sort of get these things off the ground and actually kind of activate that participation, but also to sort of sustain it over time so that it has a real impact. And I'm just wondering kind of if you know, any of you could kind of talk about those challenges. I think there's the challenge of, sort of balancing between the agendas that come with the institutional perspective and what the participants themselves might want. Just sort of the design of the project and over time just kind of keeping it funded and keeping it alive. So, thanks.
Life cycle of projects, I think, is something that no one's quite got their heads around yet, and I think it's a major challenge. I mean, it's such an interesting thing, the longitudinal dimension of work online, but it's also really challenging. I've certainly got one project which, I don't know, I haven't closed, it's still open. Oh dear, have I checked my inbox to see if anyone's emailed me recently and wants to take part? You know, this is all kind of new to us. I was so interested, Kat, that you said that you just announced the final section of High Rise. I mean, how smart. Have an end point to a project. So I think the kind of temporal dimension is really interesting and obviously scary for funders, right? The fact that, you know, this may, something may kind of go on in a kind of indeterminate way. So I think that's a kind of interesting issue. But I just one more thing in response to your question. We shouldn't give anybody the impression that this is how documentarists are working these days, you know? The future is here, but it's unevenly spread. I mean, if you call, this is the future, you know, this is the past resurrected in many ways or come to fruition. But also, many documentary makers are still working, most, in that kind of 20th century mode. And they're you know, the negotiations with the participants in their films look like they looked 50 years ago. So, or, you know, so I think that's also worth saying, that actually, you know, talking of institutions, the BBC doesn't commission this kind of work. The BBC kind of pulled back from commissioning work with much, as it was still calling it, user-generated content, a term I have contempt for, you know. But so the BBC doesn't really do that kind of work because it was too problematic. There was a phase in the late 90s, early 2000s when there was a real, you know, everyone was kind of embracing work that involved participation or user-generated content. And then suddenly, like somebody said one day, we've got a message board over here and these two guys are just using it to discuss what they're having for lunch and the BBC's paying all this money for this. And alarm bells went off through the institution. I mean, that's to characterise it. And so around 2000, around 2004, 2005, there was a shift in the kind of strategic direction. And this involved a kind of decision to use the web in support of linear programs rather than as a platform in itself. And the kind of, you know, experimentation with web-native work really disappeared for a number of years. It's coming back now, I'm happy to say. And a lot of that work involved forms of participation. So, yeah.
I think we have time for one more question.
Oh, sorry. Thank you to the four of you. You each brought really amazing examples, works of art, and good ideas and arguments to this conversation. I'd like to just quickly come back to the word story, which has been my obsession since I wrote the first word I could spell. Because for me, when I'm listening to your approach, which sounds absolutely fascinating, I translate the word data into story elements. Because when we build a story, if I put myself on the storyteller's side, we make choices. We choose elements, story elements, data, that we find interesting. How do we find these elements interesting? It depends who we're going to tell them to. I think that you're, I totally empathize with your discomfort, because when we choose elements to tell a story, we choose them because we have somebody who we will be telling this story to or who will be listening to our story. In the case of your participants, they are mapping and collecting data for you, which is not intended to tell a story, but inevitably, they are building stories, but it's not the same thing of connecting. But you don't want them to tell stories, and you feel uncomfortable that they want to tell you their story. Anyways, I find it very fascinating, because if you walked in there as a filmmaker, let's say like Kat, and say, hi, I'm interested in, you know, your community, it would be nice if you could collect this data about your abandoned houses and all that. They would be collecting it differently to please you. You know, the mandate would not be the same. Anyways, I'm just wondering about, because I'm listening to both of you, the four of you, actually, and the same thing with the BBC video experiment. You said yourself they knew they would be seen by BBC audiences, and it's something that I've been obsessed with for really, literally all my life. Do we tell a story differently if we know that it's my neighbor listening, or if it's my lover, or if it's my mother? We will choose the story elements in a different way and organize them in a different way. So that's it.
So for the work that we're trying to do, there's three paradigms sort of at work and possibly in conflict. The big trend right now in sort of urban planning and design is let's get as much data as we can, and then we'll figure out the problem of the city. I think this is a terrible idea. I think it's dangerous. I think it's broken in all sorts of different ways. So I wanted to look for a path that put deciding to collect data and deciding to frame the data into the hands of individuals. Because what I end up teaching is basically journalism, ended up with a very journalistic model. And the way that we tend to use stories in journalism is something that we call the martini glass structure. You start with a story, and you sort of say, here is the story of this building in downtown Sao Paulo and the fact that it's being protected by the police for people occupying it. And then you spread out. And the reason you spread out is, in journalism, what you're trying to show is that this story that I've told you is an exemplar. It's characterizes a whole set of phenomena. So I'm telling you this story because this story is playing itself out in 1,000 buildings in Sao Paulo and in 10,000 buildings around Brazil, and therefore it becomes a much broader and more important story. So I thought that's what we were going to do with this project. What we found, of course, is as soon as you put someone out to tell a story, they're telling their story. And so right now, we're wrestling with this tension between, is our job to get geodata about a different way of mapping a city? Is it to find stories that help people understand this larger phenomenon in the city? Or is it to allow people to tell their own stories, either as advocates or just as storytellers in one fashion or another? But I think what I would ask you to reflect on here is that it's a very different problem whether you're coming to it as a documentarian, as a storyteller, than if you're coming at it as an urban planner, for instance. And where you find yourself standing when you start on it has a lot to do with what your inclinations are for how you try to build the system out. I don't know if that resonates for any of you, but that's sort of what I'm wrestling with in this case.
It's interesting you talk about the way we frame our stories to whom we're speaking with, and that's very much at the core of the next documentary that we're the final documentary, where I've become really interested in the question of how documentary, and in particular the co-creative model, can be a conversation, and that in fact documentary is a conversation. And so how can we use these new technologies to start replicating or coming closer to that unpredictable art of conversation that is so wonderful, that again is another kind of magic that can be incredibly powerful in all these ways, whether it be urban planning or human rights or telling meaningful news at, was it 10:45 in the evening?
10:28 actually.
10:28 every evening. There's just so many things to talk about. I feel like we're just at the beginning of defining and starting to understand what co-creation can be in what you talk about as the 21st century storytelling, where we have these technologies that are challenging, radically challenging what it is to be human on the planet, I think we're all advocating that co-creation or some approximation thereof helps to keep up with that technology and helps to keep us really fit in terms of those sticky questions that we need to ask ourselves, not after we've done the work, not after we've collected the data, but really from the very, very beginning. So at that, with that, I'm gonna leave this. I think there's one more.
One more.
Quick one. I drove in from the Cape for this.
I thought I'd finish that
off. I really
appreciate
it. Thank you very much. My question is specifically going back to documentary filmmaking as a specific goal or aspect. By nature, when I've engaged with subjects, I tend to believe that for me to get to know how someone experiences the world, I have to ask them to show me. Show me how you see this or how you feel this. And so necessarily to have me follow in their footsteps to get a mapping, if you would, of the way that they experience their reality, right? Well, now I'm working on a film for HBO. I'm co-producing it, and it's just me and the director, and this is like an on-the-ground question, right? I'm sort of challenged with this notion of not being too collaborative because it's getting in the way of the narrative. So it's about, and I've been accused in a very nice way, not by the director, but by someone else, as being defined as a feminist filmmaker because I'm working in what's being seen as a more collaborative process with our subjects. And I'm being challenged at the level of, in those moments when you're engaging with folks in the reality that they're going through, making decisions in that space of not inserting myself into the narrative. And I was wondering if you have any sort of feedback or sort of observations on how you manage and navigate those moments when you're literally in the field working with subjects and you have to make a decision about, I want to collaborate. I think that the most powerful way to tell a story is to get inside someone else's reality, but at the same time I'm being challenged, being told, you're getting too close to the subjects. You're too close. That you have to be able to maintain this sort of individuated, sort of boundaried space. So I just thought it'd be very helpful if anyone has any feedback. Thanks.
Oh, goodness. This is 90 minutes of discussion that you've opened up. Really, I think there's one answer. I think you have to go with your heart, you know? But it just makes me think as well, there's an article I've been meaning to write called The Two Participations, because, you know, Bill Nichols, the documentary scholar, defines participatory documentary as the kind of documentaries we began to see from 1960 on, where sometimes, in the case of the French model, the, you know, cinema vérité model, Rouch and collaborators were seen on camera in discussion with their subjects. And that was the kind of participation Bill Nichols speaks about as participation. So we have many participations in this equation. And I want to no more in response to your question than say that, you know, those things are things we have to think about, the kind of levels at which we make our participation evident to the audience. And in a way, that's a decision you make about what you want to show, because you don't show every inch of the rushes. So it's kind of a question of what you want to show to your audience, what you want to invite them to consider as part of your filmmaking.
Yeah, some of the toughest ethical questions around what to do with material or people or politics that you're working with as a documentarian, I think, when you build them, when you bring them into the story, it actually helps on so many different fronts. It helps on the politics of the situation where you're actually discussing it, you're putting it on the table, but it also makes for a better story, a more interesting story, because the stories that matter are the ones that have real questions in them and that you actually confront them, that you don't go behind assumptions and conventions that don't challenge everyone involved in the process about what's going on here. With that, I bid you a good night.